So this is the project which is the prologue to the workshop and was produced through a fellowship at the New Institute last year. So I was invited to be a research fellow. The larger premise of the work is looking at the history of political theater, workers' theater, and performance at the turn of the century, but specifically the interbellum period, so between the Russian Revolution and World War II, and asking, let's say, within this contemporary moment or this political present, what are the means of communication, of representation from that time that we might want to revisit and reconsider and reuse, reappropriate in ways. And it's kind of a, you know, again, a large breadth of research that I'm conducting. But the way I'm trying to organize it and publicly disseminate it is through adaptations of texts or moments of that period and producing my own kind of theatrical renditions of it. Does that make sense? And so the first one is The Jungle. So The Jungle was is a novel written in 1906 by Upton Sinclair. It's considered a classic. It's called a muckraking novel. So it was there were a group of very socially oriented writers at the time who were trying to uncover some of the problems of capitalism already emerging. So lack of workers' rights, lack of proper care, healthcare, otherwise. And they were doing do so through novel writing, and the term muckraking is when you rake through shit, basically. So they were the ones that were kind of like revealing to America what was actually happening. You know, again, this great, kind of great moment of commodification, consumerism is emerging at the turn of the century through industrialization, but there are consequences, there are victims. And the victims are inherently the workers. So this is a view of Chicago. This is a view of the Yards, called the Yards in Chicago in 1906. You can see on the far right, it's literally a whole city of animal killing, basically. So and there are train tracks running above the yards, right? So all of these small fences are filled with cows and pigs and sheep. And then the railroad is bringing all of this livestock from the west, depositing in Chicago, and then literally overnight, the entire kilometer of cows and sheep are slaughtered, packaged, and then put back on the trains and driven out to New York, to all the major urban hubs. I mean, it was an astonishing piece of engineering. And then within that are a working class, most of them immigrants who are arriving, quote unquote, for the American dream, who are enduring the worst kinds of workers' situations, basically. And these are photographs that I purchased the exhibition rights to from the Library of Congress. And these are the photographs that are sanctioned by the meatpacking companies themselves. So these are like the good pictures, you know. This shows you how good the conditions are. But it already looks like a horror film. And in fact, the conditions were far worse. And The Jungle, this book, really exposed it. So it really reads like a piece of journalism. It speaks of absolutely horrible working and living conditions, the inability to make a decent wage. So they were being paid not enough to survive, even in the most lowliest of tenements. You know, these are like giant vats of soup production that occasionally a worker would just fall in and no one would know. You know, and when it was drained, they would find the bones of that. And there was just literally no support or conditions of dignity for these people. And the book really exposed it to the point that quite a lot of legislation was enacted after the publication of the book. Yeah, it's great for like before lunch. I mean, yeah, if you don't want to eat meat ever again, like I really have difficulty now. But ultimately, well, so I tried to. So the idea was to adapt this into a theatrical play or a kind of a series of performances. And so again, the text that I really oriented the work with. within was the book itself. So this is a German edition designed by John Hartfeld. I don't know how many of you know him, but a kind of very important anti-fascist graphic designer. A theoretical text by Owen Hathaway called The Chaplin Machine, and then a manifesto by a group of young Soviet avant-gardists called the Eccentrics. Great name. None of them were over 24 years old, so that's also hopefully kind of inspiration to you guys. But they were a group that were really trying to draw out, let's say, popular forms and elevate them so that the working class, the proletariat, could really enjoy some of the more educational material that they were being provided. So circus, cabaret, burlesque, these types of forms that were considered popular or low, they elevated and combined with, let's say, more traditional dance and theater to produce their new kind of proletariat art forms and proletariat performance. And these are some more theoretical texts. And then, so Upton Sinclair, the novel that he wrote, was actually heavily distributed in the early Soviet Union. He was the he was one of the great favorites of the early Soviet system because of his rendering of the, basically the failures of capitalism and the plight of the workers. This great set of images. Okay. These are images from some Eccentric films. So again, this is part of the research where I'm trying to take the book and find the materials that were already being developed within that period on the Soviet side into some theatrical representation that really wears the influences on its sleeve. You know, like the means of production, the means of representation. I wanted to sort of maintain some of the integrity of how it was being done at that time and bring it forward and just see. Was it interesting? Was it, did it resonate in any way? So one of the key issues being addressed at the time in the Soviet era was the new man, the new man to represent the new energies of, hopefully, for the Soviet Union, industrialization. So they saw, just as they saw it in America, that industrialization was a kind of form of liberation. It just had to be separated from capitalism, and it could produce a wonderful new Soviet populace that could integrate with machinery, but have time for the arts, etc. And it was all kind of perfectly embodied in Charlie Chaplin. For them, Charlie Chaplin was God, because he already was a kind of lumpen proletariat, right? He was poor, he didn't have any money, he was being ostracized all the time, but he also had the tics of a machine. I mean, he's doing, you know, like robot dancing here pretty exceptionally. And so he already embodied the kind of energies of this new man, who was already, you know, most of you have seen Modern Times, where he's on the conveyor, and then he's sort of stuck with the kind of motion of what he's doing. And it's not for nothing that, you know, at some point in Charlie Chaplin's career, he became very political. I mean, he was one of the richest men in the world, but he was very much attached to socialist causes. And Upton Sinclair, who wrote The Jungle, was effectively his political advisor. So this is Upton Sinclair with Chaplin. So there's a kind of, again, for in terms of artistic research, there's a kind of triangle here of, for me, of the book itself, the Soviets' interest in Upton Sinclair, and in the notion of the kind of new energies of the period, which is a kind of congruence of people and machines. Of course, we know that this went very, very wrong. You know, we have the kind of all of the 20th century in hindsight to recognize that this was not a liberating entity. And then Chaplin and Sinclair as kind of collaborators. And then also through residency, I started the process of kind of translating this into materials, and so I kind of, instead of writing notes about the text, I started to draw. I just sort of draw images from the text, or draw drew, like illustrated images rather than doing too much kind of writing. And then proposed this initially to the gallery, in Plymouth. But you'll see a lot of changes were made. But this hopefully kind of spoke of the energy of what I was trying to do. And it spoke of a few objects, of what Anik really nicely described as performative objects. So objects that kind of have a performing entity within them. They might be animated by someone else, or they might have those properties. They might be mechanized or electric in some capacity, but they are alive in some capacity. They perform. And then also a proposal for a dance performance. So the dance performance starts with a kind of acting technique that was developed at the time by Wieselow Meyerhold called biomechanics. And this is what we are in the workshop going to be doing. By the end of 2 hours, we'll be in this formation, I promise you. But ultimately, it was an acting technique where the actors, sort of opposite to the Stanislavski technique, the actors were meant to physically embody the energy. It was all external, so they became really very expressive in their performances. And he produced a series of acting techniques which was meant to kind of draw those out. And within it, you can already see a kind of coordination of people that starts to resemble machinery in some capacity. So again, trying to draw from the energy and synchronicity of industrialization and bring it to the people, let them inhabit these motions. Does that make sense? And this is the gang, the work, and you can see Hanukkah, raise your hand. Hanukkah is there. She was interning with Alexa Pullman, who's just next to me, who's an exceptional fashion and costume designer. And then Nick Williamson, who is a kind of a surreal engineer, I would say. And so we worked together and proposed a series of objects. And then we also were able to work with Julie Cunningham, who's just a kind of world-class choreographer and dancer. And the brief that we gave, Julie was to one, read the book, and to look at Meyerhold's acting etudes, techniques from the period, and produce her own variations, and then she would perform it for the opening night. And then at the same time, Alexa was producing this kind of satirical take on the chorus girl and on synchronicity, so mass ornament. Logic. This is a produced. This was in the Weimar period. This is the names are Chit and Ina von Elben. This is the Tingle Tangle object. So there's two performers, one on the front, one on the back, and then they're multiplied as dummies inside. And so Alexa produced her own version, one which was meant to be activated by Julie Cunningham, the dancer. So. It's a kind of giant marionette machine. And the idea was that it could serve both as a representation of the kind of coordination of work and to some extent the dehumanization of it, but also to the notion of protest, that if you can coordinate a body in work, you can also coordinate it as a form of protest, that together, in line, in sync, you produce a form of protest. So there's Hanukkah testing out a early model. And then that's a fuller scale version. And then Alex also produced her own fabric based on Varvara Stepanova's textiles of the time. You can see kind of celebrating the industrialization of the Soviet Union, tractors, railroads. And then at the same time, she was producing a series of masks, one of which Julie was going to use for her performance. We're also going to be making masks in the workshop. So this is just a process pick. And the masks are, each one is based on one of the characters from the book. And then along with that, I produced these quite graphic banners, which are based on strike bibs from the time. So again, you were issued this from your union, so you know, you'd come in, you'd get your cup of coffee, you're going on strike as a member of the Meatpackers Union, and then you are in front of the judge or the court district in your strike bibs. And then also I wanted to draw out some audio material from the time. So the idea, I'll show you the installation later, but the idea is that there's a soundtrack to the show, to the installation. I sourced a series of blues recordings and political speeches from the era, and the idea, although it didn't really work so well for it, was that visitors could come, or an invigilator would be there with visitors when they arrived, and then they would put on a record, old 78, so it's a wind-up gramophone, and as they moved through the space, there would be this soundtrack. Yeah? This is one of them. So just to get a flavor, this is Hard Time Blues by Ida Cox. Okay. And then another sculpture that was produced that is connected to the record player is a rendition of this sculpture in the Ukraine. So this is the first. This is a commemorative sculpture in Kiev that depicts the first. Kind of youth worker strike in 1917 in the Soviet in Russia, and then I found on eBay for very very affordable a small statue of it that I used as part of the sculpture, which you'll see. So again, these are constructivist sculptures also that I drew heavily from, and these are some of the kind of proposed drawings for some of the sculptures. So the idea is, one of them is that the record player, while he plays the soundtrack, also is the motor for this sculpture that's spinning. And the work is titled Monument to the Revolution. So also the revolution, which is a workers' revolution, but the revolution of a record player. So it's spinning at 78 revolutions per minute. And then working with Nick Williamson, who's the engineer, you know, you start to develop ideas about what these quite mechanically oriented sculptures can be, and then he comes back with these tests. So the spinning record, and then one of the largest, most ambitious pieces is this pig grinding machine at full scale. So he was testing out a kind of mechanism. And then this is a more coherent proposal for the revolution sculpture. And then, you know, this is where, for this project, you really wanted to also make visible the research, you know, to not have such a huge translation. So I can pass that around. That was the brochure that came with the show, was to show where the influence came from. So this is a really seminal constructivist set design by Varvara Stepanova for a Meyerhold production called The Death of Tarelkin in 1922. So that's her building the set on the left, and that's the set being used. And you see this giant grinding machine in the set. So we reappropriated it to be this like pig grinding machine. And these are, again, the kind of series of iterations that we worked on. This is, you know, you send, so I would send Nick a drawing like that, and he would come back with already a kind of heavily rendered, engineered object that he could build. And then we settled for something that looks like this. So I'll now, I just need to find the slide, and that'll pretty much conclude the talk. Again, the collaborative process here was really super important. Also, that I was out of control for much of it. So in the end, the way that I was working with Alexa and with Nick was to provide them with a brief that really provided them with enough focus, but of course, opportunity for interpretation. And then just let them do what they do, you know, trust in the people that you work with. Oh, this is a larger image of the show. You see the objects. There's the pig machine. So on one side there's a pig that is basically being eaten. Like you could spin the mechanism and then this pig gets eaten in. And on the other side, commodities come out, sausages, cans of lard, things like that. And then the other, I think, integral thing that we were trying to do was because this is a gallery in a connected to a large institution, University of Plymouth. And so one thing we did was after the initial the opening night with Julie Cunningham, I can show a bit of her performance. The program for the work was given over to the students, basically. So students were encouraged to propose talks or exhibitions within the setting of the space, so long as it kind of connected to the notions, to the themes, and then they were allowed to do whatever they wanted to, because also, you know, I was flying in and flying out, so there was no chance for me to be there to kind of curate or make coherent what was being discussed. But what was nice was that they, you know, quite a few students applied to produce programmation. It was really a nice moment. And I'll just show quickly Julie's presentation. That'll be it. I'll be right on time. She's performing with thank you.